just rise to our feet and we'll read together Psalm 100. Read along with me. Psalm 100. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good. His love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. How privileged, right? Like, his faithfulness continues through all generations. And, you know, even as I was preparing for this week, there's something that, that was really impressed on my heart. I'm going to read from you from Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. It says, now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. And in verse 6, it says, without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists, and he rewards those who seek him earnestly. So it's as plain as that. We just have to believe. Okay, it's a choice. We have to believe that he exists. We have to choose to believe. We have to choose faith over every circumstance that we see. So it's as simple as that. As complicated as our lives are right now, I know the pandemic has changed a lot of things for us. The way we think, the way we talk, the way we interact with people has changed, but God is still there. Our faithful one is still there. So let us choose faith over our situations. Let us choose to praise him over our situations. Yes, let's sing this song along.
Thank you. on, let's give the Lord a big hand of praise. Amen. And the faith that we have in Jesus, it always stays the same. You know why? Because He stays the same always. And today, He's a God whom we can always put our trust in. Like when you read the Bible, you don't have to think, man, is this the same God that I'm reading about? Can this God still feed 5,000, 4,000, 10,000 people maybe? Can He still do that? Yeah, absolutely He can. Is that the same miracle-working God that I am worshiping today? Absolutely, yes. And the best part is He's not far away. He's not in a universe. He does not have to be summoned, you know. But He is here. He is within you. He is all around you. So let's sing this song. Let's just say, You are here. My Father, You are here. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship You. I worship You. You are here, working in this place. I worship You. I worship You. In the darkness, my God, that is who You are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who You are. So You are here, touching every heart. I worship You. I worship You. You are here, healing every heart. I worship You. Yes, I do. I worship You. You are here, turning lives around. I worship You.
You're working, never stop, never
stop working. Never stop, never stop working.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working.
Cannot fathom how big you are. Our human minds can't fathom, Lord, the grandness and the majesty. But that is who you are, God. You are big. You are grand, O Father. You're the one who created everything that we see around us. Father, I pray that we'll just soak in the majesty and the magnitude of who you are, Father. for the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. Holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. What is the
free. that we will continue doing here on earth and in heaven above. We will praise you, Father. You are God. Oh, our King of Kings, we will praise you. Our Lord of Lords, we will praise you. God, you are God. When we stand on a mountaintop, and even when we are in the valley low, you are God. When all things works out right and fall into places, and even when things are not right, when everything fails, you are God. When we have health, you are God. And even in our sicknesses, you are God. Lord, we choose to praise you no matter what, for you are God. There is no one who deserves our praise except you. So God, this morning we worship you. Church, tell the Lord, oh, there is no one like you. Father, we worship you. We lift you up. You deserve our praise. You deserve our lives. You deserve it, God. And we give it all to you this morning. God, we give it all to you. We thank you for your great love. We thank you. We know who you are. And we are privileged. We are blessed this morning. We are blessed, Father. Even this season where we are praying for our children, Father, once again, we come before your throne. Lord, stretch out your hand. Let this rising generation be set apart for you. Shape their minds and their hearts, O Lord. Let them know you deeper. O God, set them apart for your name, for your glory. We also pray for Ukraine and Russia. Father, you can bring peace. You are able. With your mighty hand, you will stretch forward and do great wonders for the world to see and know that you are God. So we speak peace upon this land. We also bring Sri Lanka into your hand. Father, we pray. Oh, our providence comes from the Lord. And this nation, which is failing right now, you can restore them back. Father, we believe in you. Even right now, we believe that you're working. Though we don't see it, you are working. So we stand along with our brothers and sisters in Sri Lanka. Father, we pray, come through. Change the situation. Let it be for your glory. Let it be for your glory. Let it be for your glory. Our lives for your glory. There is a praise point, church. Praise God for healing Brother David and his family. Can we give the Lord a big clap offering? You must have received some testimonies. If you have received healing, give it to the Lord. Oh, that's not enough for the Lord. Come on. We will continue praying for the sick among us. And so if you have any sickness in your body, if there is any healing that you are asking the Lord, can we lift up our hands to the Lord and make him known? If there is anything that you're waiting on, oh, if you're waiting for your prayers to be answered, can we lift it up to the Lord once again? Father, there is no time in history where a man or a woman calls out to you asking for help and you have rejected them. So God, we stand in confidence even this morning as we pray for our brothers and sisters. Father, even in their sickbed, even when they are not well, even in their difficult season, we know you will come through for them. So God, in oneness, we lift up Annie Thomas. We lift up Sukumaran, Father. We lift up Lisa. We lift up Saroj Sendra. We lift up Daisy. and we speak healing into their body right now as we stand before your presence in the name of Jesus. By the authority that you have given us, we speak healing into these bodies, that kidneys will be restored, eyesight will be restored, diabetes and blood pressure will come to normal, leukemia will be vanished, cancers will be healed in Jesus' name. Every weak legs, every sickness of the body, every weaknesses will be made whole in Jesus' name. And you see the hands that are lifted to you, Father. We receive healing, for there is power in the name of Jesus, and we speak this power into our bodies, into the body of Christ, and receive this healing. We also pray for the comfort of Brother Michael Sharon, who passed away yesterday. Oh God, we have hope in you, hope that the world does not have. What a hope it is that we will meet once again. Brother has gone before us, but there is sure hope that we will spend eternity with him, with you in heaven. So God, we pray, let your comfort and peace surround this family. Give them joy and hope even right now. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. And church says, God, amen, amen. Please be seated. Here are a few announcements for this morning. We have a youth event coming up on 28th of May. Church, any youth, if you say you are youth of our church, can I see your hand, please? Because this is a good news for you. Yes, some of the youth are like a little confused. Yeah. So here it is, youth. We would like to discuss and rekindle the desires for God in our hearts. We call this event Zeal because we want to have zeal and passion for God. Block your day today and your time. 28 May at 4:30. We shall be providing you with link for registration, so keep a watch on our social media page. Each one of us are gifted in many ways, and we are all uniquely shaped. Can we turn to our neighbors and say, you are uniquely shaped, you are gifted. Imagine how much we can do together, how much we can accomplish for the Lord if we all serve together. And here is your opportunity. We have MOH, Ministry of Help, where you can serve along with us. If we all join our hands together and serve the Lord, we know that God is going to do great things, mighty things than before. So encouraging you, register today for Ministry of Help. You can get the details from our help desk, or you can also contact your life group leaders. Baptism classes is happening. If you would like to have more information on this, contact our help desk. Marriage Bureau is happening every Monday and Saturdays. The timing is 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. You can meet the consent team in our mother's room. So every Mondays and Saturdays, Marriage Bureau is happening. Well, that's all for today. Let's give unto the Lord cheerfully. I will take hold of you.
you, Jesus, to come to my rescue. Where else can I go? There's no other name by which I am saved. Capture me with grace, I will follow you. To my rescue, where else can I go? There's no other name by which I am saved. Capture me with grace, I will follow you. 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 This world is nothing. I will follow you. This world. I will follow. I will follow. I will follow you. Nothing. I need you, Jesus, come to my rescue. Where else can I go? There's no other name by which I am saved. I need you, Jesus, come to my rescue. Where else can I go?
Where else can I go?
There's no other name.
No other name by
which I am saved.
Capture me with grace.
Won't you capture me?
Capture me with grace. Capture me with grace.
I will follow you. Jesus, we follow you. Would you lift up your hands and everyone asking God, God, come to our rescue. This is our cry this morning. Come to our rescue. I do not know what your situation is. I do not know what you're going through this morning. I do not know what is your family situation. I do not know what is the trouble that you are going through. I do not know what is the financial situation of your life. But all that you can do is lift up your hands to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, who is your Father in heaven, and tell him, God, come rescue me. Oh God, come rescue me. That one cry, that one prayer will change the situation of your life. That one cry, that one prayer, this God of heaven will listen to you. He will come. He will change your situation. He will change it forever. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lead us. Guide us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Can we give the Lord a big hand of praise this morning? You may be seated in God's presence. Amen. You may be seated in God's presence. Are you glad to be in the house of Jesus? If you are, shout a big hallelujah. Come on, this is not enough. Can I hear a bigger shout of hallelujah? I want you to turn your attention to Psalms. And chapter 31 and verses 1 to 5. Psalms and chapter 31 verses 1 to 5. There are times in our lives that we go through where we know that we have no other way out. There's no other way out. You've tried every door, but that door doesn't open up. You tried all resources and sources, but everything is almost coming to an end. And then you lift up your eyes and you cry out to this God of heaven and earth. And I say, oh God, come to my rescue. These times, the book of Psalms becomes such a live portion of our life. Where we go to the Psalms, because David and many of the psalmists who wrote those psalms went through very, very tough times. And during those tough times, they cried unto God. And always God answered. Amen. And this morning, I want to declare to you, this God of heaven and earth answers your prayer. He answers your prayer. He answers everything that you have. So this morning, let's read out Psalms chapter 31 and verses 1 to 5. Everyone together. In you, Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Deliver me in your righteousness. Turn your ear to me. Come quickly to my rescue. Be my rock of refuge. A strong fortress to save me. Since you are my rock and my fortress, for the sake of your name, lead and guide me. Keep me free from the trap that is set for me. For you are my refuge. Into your hands I commit my spirit. Deliver me, Lord, my faithful God. I want you to lift up your voices and say, into your hands I give my spirit. Everyone say this. Into your hands I give my spirit. Come, deliver. Come, deliver me. Desperate times require desperate calls. And instead of actually calling different places and looking for earthly source of comfort, looking for earthly source of help, I want to direct your attention to your Father in heaven. Come, deliver us. Come, rescue us. Come, rescue me. Should be the yearning, the cry that comes from your heart this morning. If the sermon is for one person who's seated here, let it be worth. Because he's interested about every individual here. We could come together as a mass, as a group, as a crowd. But he's actually concerned about every individual here. At the end of this service, if you would cry out, oh God, come rescue me. He will come and save you. He will come and redeem you. He will come and deliver you. He will come and heal you. He will come and set you free. But this morning, my task, and why I'm here to speak these words is because the Spirit of God wants you to come and experience Him as your Father. Experience Him as your Father. When you go through those desperate times and difficult times, I want you to experience Him as your Father. In my life, growing in Christ and growing as a disciple, one of the things that I've really come to comprehend is, hey, He's my God, true. He's my Savior, true. He's my Lord, true. But more than anything, He is my Father. At times that you have great times and everything is going great, but you fail to understand who this God is, the more difficulties I've gone through in my life, I have come to understand about this loving, loving Father. He is my Father, and He needs to be your Father. Come experience. While you go through these difficult times and that, and through the book of Psalms, I'm going to highlight to you that this God is your Father, and you and I need to experience Him as a Father. And that's the reason why I want to talk about five most important aspects about this Father. And if you continue to call out to Him, this Father will descend from heaven. This Father will stand by your side. This Father will come and break through the things that are needed to break through. This Father will carry you. This Father will care for you. This Father will lay His hands upon you. This Father will do all that is needed for you to set you free this morning. Amen. And the first aspect I want you to know is that this Father sees you. Sees your condition. Sees the difficulties that you're going through. You have no opportunities in your life. You can actually belong to any religion and cry out this and say, hey, where are you? Do you even know me? Do you even see me? But I want to tell you this morning, this Father sees you. This Father sees you. Therefore, call on Him. Hagar was in a very difficult and desperate situation. It was not her call. It was not her desire to be pregnant with Ishmael. Abraham and Sarah talked about it. Here she's a slave. Here she's a servant. She has to do whatever the masters wanted her to do. And here she's pregnant. She knew that this is not God's will and plan for Abraham. Abraham had made a mistake. Abraham and Sarah came together and were running ahead of God. This was not the promised son. Yes, sure, Hagar should not have actually ill-treated or did things against her master, Abraham and Sarah, but now Sarah, Hagar is in a very difficult situation. She's sent out. She's a victim. She's a person who is with her child, a male born, a son, Ishmael. And she is going through the wilderness and absolutely no water in the wilderness. Nobody to care for. When she looks, she sees only wilderness, only the desert. There's no hope for life. Here, her son is going to die and she's going to die. And that is the situation when she calls out to God. And this morning, I want to declare to you, whatever the situation is, it does not matter. Even when it's a failure, it's not even God's will for your life. And you feel like, man, everyone is victimizing you and sending you out and you have no hope. I want you to call unto this God. And this Father will come down to you. This Father will come down to you. And this Father says to Hagar, Genesis chapter 16 and verse 13 to 14, she gave this name to the Lord who spoke to her, "You are the God who sees me." For she said, "I have now seen the one who sees me. I have now seen the one who sees me." This God is a God who sees you. You got to turn your eyes towards Him and see the one who sees you. Psalms chapter 10 and verse 14. Psalms chapter 10 and verse 14. I want you to read this with me. "But you, God, see the trouble of the afflicted. You consider their grief and take it in hand. The victims commit themselves to you. You are the helper of the fatherless." You are the helper of the fatherless. I do not know what the desperate situation you are going through in your life. Maybe it's financial. Maybe it's your health. Maybe you're going through certain things that you can't explain to others. Nobody will understand you. But this morning, this God is a God who sees you. Turn your eyes to Him and see the one who sees you. See the one who sees you. Your Father is a Father who sees. Secondly, I want you to know that this father is a father who embraces you. He's a father who embraces you. You sometimes think that this father embraces you only when you are right, when you have done right. No, this father is not a father who embraces you not only when you do right, even when you are in the filth of your sins. This father is able to embrace you. Yes, he will not be able to stand the sin that you and I do, but yet you, he will embrace. You, he will hold on. Pastor Jacob John, who frequents and he preaches, he's from Canada. One of the times when he was preaching, he highlighted an incident that happened in his sister's life. His sister lives in UK, and while their children were young, the son actually did something wrong, and the mother actually started to speak and tell, hey, what you've done is wrong. And the son actually started to shudder and say, hey, you know what? I'm feeling so sad, mommy. I'm feeling so sad, mommy. And instead of actually running away from mommy, he started to run towards mommy and held on to mommy and said, mommy, do something. I am feeling really sad. He's the one who's committed mistake. She's the one who wants to discipline this son who's done the mistake. Instead of running away from the mother, this boy started to run towards the mother. And that is what God is wanting you today to do. Instead of running away from him, because everything within us says, this God is going to punish. This God is going to actually discipline me. This God is going to actually finish me off. Instead of running away from him, you got to run towards him. Luke chapter 15 talks about this parable of the lost son. But it's not the parable of a lost son. Actually, it's a parable of a loving father. This loving father is waiting for this lost son. This lost son, he actually fought with his father, fought with his elder brother, took all the wealth and his share, and went and squandered it. Now, after he has squandered everything, he's sitting in amongst where the pigs are actually eating the food. Then he comes to his senses and he says, oh, in my father's house, even the least of the servants could have better food than what I'm eating. I'm going back to my father. This morning, he is expecting you to come back to him. Come back to him. Don't run away from him. He is a father who will embrace you. And that is what Luke chapter 15 says in verse 20. So this prodigal son got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him. Because this father is a father who sees. This father is a father who waits. This father is a father who's actually waiting for you to come. But when you are turning towards him, he knows. And he's not waiting for you to fully come. He's beginning to run towards you. He's beginning to run towards you. And he throws his arms around him. His father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him and kissed him. David was a man after God's own heart. But just like every king, he went and counted his army. There was nothing wrong for kings to count the army. But for Israel, it was wrong. Why? Because it is not the strength of the army that helped them win the victories. It was God who was their protector. It was God who was their healer. It was God who was their deliverer. But instead of depending on God, David went and counted all the army men. When he counted, God's anger came against David. And immediately he sent a prophet named Gad to David, and God, the prophet, comes and confronts David and tells to David, David, you have sinned against the Lord. You have gone against the will of God. And the immediate response of David is, now I realize I have not done the will of God. I would rather fall into the hands of God. And I want you to turn your attention to 2 Samuel chapter 24 and verse 14. David said to Gad, I am in deep distress. Let us fall into the hands of the Lord, for his mercy is great, but do not let me fall into the human hands. There are times in my life that I've committed mistake and I've run into God's presence and I've fell prostrate before him and say, God, please, because everyone is straining their mouth against me. Everyone is raising their hands against me. Only you can help. And I want to tell you that this God will come as a solution for the problem. You could have caused the mistake. You could have done the problems. You could have been the sinner. You could have done the worst thing. But run to him. Even if he punishes me, he will be merciful. He will be gracious. Even if he disciplines me, he will never forsake me. That's who your father is. Have you experienced him? The call this morning is for you to experience your father. Yes, you know him as the Lord and Savior of your life. But in desperate times like these that you are going through, I want you to know that this is a father who loves you. This is a father who waits for you. This is a father who actually is waiting to embrace you, to hold you. Have you experienced him? Have you experienced him? If you have not experienced him, because you have always processed him as someone distant, no, he's not a distant God. He's near you. He will never forsake you. He comes to you and he throws his arms around you and he wants to embrace you. Thirdly, I want you to know that when you go through difficult times and desperate times, this is a father who actually protects you and carries you. He protects you and he carries you. This is who your father is. He walks with you. When Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were thrown into that fiery furnace, oh, our expectation is that this God will take a bucket of water and pour. No, the bucket of water can't quench this fire. This was 7 times larger. It was a huge furnace. Our expectation is that that problem would be gone. No, sometimes the problem is not gone. He comes into that problem. He walks with you in that problem. You're in a storm and you don't know what to do. And this father actually starts to walk with you. Sometimes when you can't walk any longer, he actually carries you in his arms. And sometimes I've experienced that he's not just holding me in his arms, but he's carrying me on his shoulders. That I'm able to see the things beyond the problem. Because here, when you're walking through that valley of sorrows, you're not able to see your hand in front of your face. Everything is dark. Everything is bleak. Everything does not have a future. But this morning I want to tell you that he carries you not just in his arms. He carries you and puts you on his shoulders. He's a tall, tall father. He's a tall, tall father. And he gives you perspective. Hey, you see the storms are here. You see the darkness here. You see the difficulty here. But come, climb on my shoulders. I'm holding you. And I'm walking through that problem. But while you walk through the problem, that problem is not forever. This problem is not forever. You are able to see beyond that problem. Do you see light there? Do you see storm-free seasons there? Come. He hid Daniel from the mouth of the lions. That's who your God is. That's who your God is. He will carry you. He will carry you. I want you to read these passages. Isaiah chapter 46 and verse 3 and 4. Listen to me, you descendants of Jacob, all the remnant of the people of Israel, you whom I have upheld since your birth and carried since you were born. even to your old age and gray hairs. I am He. I am He who will sustain you. I have made you and I will carry you. I have made you, I will carry you. This is the promise. If God is the God who made you, He has His responsibility to carry you. I will carry you. I will sustain you. I will rescue you. Can we declare together? God, you have made me. Come on, declare together. God, you have made me. You will carry me. You will sustain me. You will rescue me. Psalm chapter 32, verse 6 and 7. Therefore, let all the faithful pray to you while you may be found. Surely the rising of the mighty waters will not reach them. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. You will surround me with songs of deliverance. You know what? There is a wonderful, wonderful anecdote about footprints on the sand. Have you gone through footprints on the sand? Most of you would have gone through. If you have not gone through, just Google it. There are wonderful, wonderful renderings of that particular thing called the footprints of the sand. In essence, or in a capsule, like I mentioned, there are times when God just walks with us. There are times that we are not able to walk anymore, and then He carries. And you know what He does while He carries? I have experienced this, where He has carried me and then He begins to sing over me. Sing over me songs of deliverance. Songs of deliverance. I love this song that Brother Isaac Joe wrote a few years ago. I'll tell you, there's no one like Jesus. When I walk through the valley of sorrows, He stood close to me. When I couldn't walk anymore, He carried me in His arms. And He walked. Yes, He walked miles for me. I'll tell you, there's no one like Jesus. I'll tell you, there's no one like Jesus. When you walk through the valley of sorrows, He stood close to me. When I couldn't walk anymore, He carried me in His arms and He walked. Yes, He walked miles for me. Can we sing together, clapping your hands? I'll tell you, there's no one like Jesus. Oh, I'll tell you, there's no one like Jesus. When I walk through the valley of sorrows, He stood close to me. When I couldn't walk anymore, He carries. When He carries, He sings songs of deliverance. He walks.
Yes, He walks.
And He walks.
Yes, He walks.
Miles. Is there a second stanza to it? Second stanza.
I know there are some mountains and hills for years to climb. So put your trust in Jesus, the name above all names.
And He would,
yes, He walks,
carry you through.
I'll tell you,
I'll tell you,
there's no one like Jesus.
Can we all sing together, everyone? I tell you,
I'll tell you there's no one like Jesus. When I walk through the valley of sorrows, He's the closest to me. When I couldn't walk anymore, He carried me in His arms. Yes, You are, yes, You are past for me. Oh, yes, He walked, yes, You are miles for me.
Can we just lift our hands and everyone? Yes, He walked,
miles for me.
When I walked through the valley of sorrows,
He's too close to me.
The Spirit of God is speaking to some of you and telling you what? I see you. I see the difficult parts that you are in. I see the torment of your mind. I see the pressures that you are going through. My child, climb up onto me. Why would you still insist on walking? Why would you still insist on just doing it with your own strength? I want to carry you. Let me carry you. For a season, hide yourself in me. Hide yourself in me for a season. For a season, hide yourself in me. For a season, hide yourself in me. I'll cause that deliverance to come through. You will turn around. Things will turn around for you. Things will turn around for you. I want to carry you. I want to sing the song of deliverance over you. I want to sing the song of deliverance over you. I want to sing the song of deliverance over you. I do not know who you are. Maybe you are listening to the voice of God through this internet or through a Facebook or through a YouTube channel. But this morning, the Spirit of God speaks to you and says, "Will you let me carry you? How long will you resist me?" I want to sing the songs of deliverance. Some of you who have been going through addictions and several times you have spoken and said, "God, release me from these addictions." Yeah, there are several times you have tried with your own strength. But I want to tell you this morning, run back into His arms. He wants to throw His arms around you. And He is going to carry you. And He is going to speak the songs of deliverance over you in the name of Jesus. Every smoking habit, I release you in Jesus' name. I release you in Jesus' name. I release every drinking habit in Jesus' name. Deliverance. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Fourthly, this Father is a father who instructs, counsels, teaches you, and defends you. He instructs, He counsels, He teaches, He delivers. I know this morning you're thinking, "Pastor, I know these things." True. Knowledge is not enough. I want you to come and experience this Father. I want you to come and experience this Father. He wants you not to just be another religious Christian who comes on a Sunday morning service or even attend a life group and say, "I'm a Christian." No, stop doing that. Come experience me as your Father. come experience the deliverance in your life, I will instruct you. I will teach you. I will counsel you in the way that you should go. I should counsel you in the way that you should go. I will deliver you. I will counsel you in the way that you should go. Psalms chapter 32 and verse 8. And everyone reading together. Psalms chapter 32 and verse 8. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. I've experienced this counsel. I've experienced his voice. Man, makes life more simple. It makes life more comfortable. Not that there's no troubles or difficulties. As long as you're in this world, you would have troubles. As long as you are in this world, you would have difficulties that you go through. But that's not the problem. That's the problem for everybody. But while you go through that trouble, while you go through that difficulty, he's there with you, counseling you with your eyes, his eyes. He will direct you. He will lead you. He will tell things that you will otherwise not know. He'll sit with you while you write your exams. I've experienced that in my life. One of the worst things that have happened to me on the April 2nd of 2006, I've narrated this story again and again. I was kidnapped. I can't tell I was kidnapped. I was not a kid. I was past a napped. I'd gone abducted. I'd gone to pray for a person. Unassumed, like they just called me for a prayer. I just went into that room, prayed for that person. And at the end of the praying, I could feel on my temple a gun. I was directed out, taken in the car, blindfolded. But that was April 2nd, but April 1st of 2006. In our 5 o'clock morning service, when I opened up to preach, the Spirit of God gave me a revelation, a vision of when the pits of hell is open, God's hand came from heaven with a signet ring. And he said, use the keys of the kingdom. At one point of time, after 3 hours of travel out of the city, I knew that the kind of highway traffic that passes by, that was my understanding. We were on a highway somewhere. 3 hours out, came to a place where everyone in that car was out except for one man who was holding me between his legs, my eyes between his legs, blindfolded. But there I could hear the counsel of God, the voice of God telling me, turn around and talk to this man. Tell him, Anna, very specifically, Anna, I need to go back to my house. My wife is pregnant. And I don't want to trouble her. Tell these three sentences. Anna, I want to go back to my home. My wife is pregnant. And I don't want to trouble her. Those sentences shifted this man forever. He was the man who actually completely, totally cooperated with me. He instructed me on every move that I need to do. In fact, he was a man from their gang. Who was actually my gang, speaking, telling what I should do, what words would actually shift, what sentences I need to speak. At the end of it, till I came back to safety, this man was there. He was a planted man in that gang by God. But those words, Anna, I want to go back home. My wife is pregnant. I don't want to trouble her. Shifted his heart so much that at the end of that process, when he let me out and he walked, he said, would you pray for me? I don't want any trouble doing what I did. Please pray for me. I was able to pray for that person and come out of that place. I want you to know that this God counsels you. Listen to him. Listen to him. He is not God who's actually obscure and not wanting to talk to you. He's a God who counsels and instructs you and teaches you what you should do. Fifthly and finally, this morning, he is your deliverer. This Father delivers you. Just trust in him. Trust in Him. Don't ever, ever mistrust this God. Just trust in Him. I still remember a court case that the church was entangled in because we had bought the piece of land by God's grace. Things are all coming together. We're in the final stages. And we believe and we hope that by God's grace, we'll be able to hit grounds and start the foundation work very soon. But while we were buying those lands, in one of the lands, there was some confusion and there was a court case. And the previous owner, who was not actually the owner of the land, put a case against. I still don't remember the exact details of the case. That's not the point here. But he took us to the court, and we knew for sure, we had inside information that we knew for sure that we will lose the case because they had actually turned against. And we were thinking that this judge who will be seated, I can't talk details because I can't speak about the legal system of India, no open public forum, that's not allowed. And therefore, I don't give details to these. But one of the things that we know that the case was not going in our favor, even though we were the rightful owners, actually putting all the money to buy that land. We were the rightful owners, and the case should be about us, and it should actually end with us. But the case was going totally in an opposite direction. I still remember my father calling that morning, a few of us, and praying together and saying, please pray. 11 o'clock, this is happening. But the judge who was supposed to come and sit that morning had certain things in his family that he could not come to the court that day. Somebody else came to that court that morning and was able to see that case in a swift manner with a fresh pair of eyes. And he said, it will be wrong to actually give that particular judgment against them. So all that he did was adjourn the case for that day because that was the final day of verdict. But he adjourned the case one more time and things turned around. And God came through and we were able to win that case for the glory of Jesus, for the honor of God. Can we give the Lord a big hand of faith? Listen to this. He is your deliverer. He is your deliverer, and He will come and rescue you and deliver you. Hold on to Him. Never give up. Never give up. He will never ever give up on you. And therefore, you never give up on this God. I want you to turn, stand up to your feet, and let's read Psalms and chapter 107 and verse 13 down to 16 and then verse 20. Psalms 107, verse 13 to 16, and then verse 20. Can we all read it together? Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, everyone. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble. And He saved them from their distress. He brought them out of darkness, the utter darkness, and broke away their chains. Let them give thanks to the Lord for His unfailing love and His wonderful deeds for mankind. For He breaks down gates of bronze and cuts through bars of iron. He sent out His word and healed them. He rescued them from the grave. How many of you believe that He will deliver us? Can we lift our hands and everyone? This morning, if you didn't understand anything, I want you to experience this, Father. When you walk through the valley of sorrows, He stood close to you. When you wait on Him, He will come through. He will come through. When you wait on Him, He will come through. And this morning, I do not know what you are going through, but I want to invite you and tell you, you will have your deliverance. You will have your deliverance. You will have your deliverance. No matter what people say, no matter what doctors say, no matter what your bank finances say, no matter what the condition of your body says, no matter how many people stand against you, no matter how many enemies are against you, no matter what people gossip against you, no matter how wrong your name has become, how shameful you feel, that is not the problem, because I have a Father My Father loves you. Jesus, would you lift up your hands and worship Jesus? Thank you. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, our God, who reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God. Comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. I do not know what you're going through, but this morning, if you're going through some things and you need this God to come and rescue you, you need this God to come and deliver you, I want you to leave your seat wherever you are and come forward, because this is a time of deliverance. This is a time of healing. This is a time of complete rescue. That God wants to rescue you. And if you are a person who says, I need that rescue, don't worry about anybody else. Just come forward. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. Come forward. Come. Come. Come.
Strength arises, we
come.
Wait upon the
come.
Lord. Come.
Don't worry about anybody
the
else.
Lord.
Come.
We will wait upon the Lord.
Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are. Come. He will never forsake you. He will never leave you. You do not face,
you won't go
weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like oh Jesus, every hand's lifted up towards this precious people, towards this precious people. The presence of God is here, and where the presence of God is, there is deliverance, there is healing, there is deliverance, there is healing, there is deliverance. Oh Jesus, thank you Father, thank you Jesus. You will come and save us. You will come and save us. You will come and save us. Father, we lay hands on each of them, for your deliverance will be their portion. Your deliverance, oh Father, will be their portion. Nobody can prevent, oh Father, from what you want to do in their lives. Nobody can prevent, oh Jesus. We trust in you. Our hope is in you, oh Father. You are our strong deliverer. Nothing can ever hinder, oh Father, what you have decided for your people. Nothing can hinder, Jesus, what you have decided for your people. And you will cause this deliverance to happen. You will cause this deliverance to happen, Jesus. Oh, I will come and say, you say to the wind,
Jesus,
he will come and save
you.
He will come and save
you.
Jesus, he will come and save
you.
Jesus, come down. deliver us.
Lift up your
come deliver us. We trust you. We trust you. We trust you. We completely trust you. We have nobody else but we come. I need you, Jesus, to come to my rescue. Where else can I go? There's no other name by which I am saved. I need you, Jesus, to come to my rescue. Where else can I go? Jesus, come, go. There's no other name by which I am saved. Capture me with grace. Once again, can we all lift our hands? I need you, Jesus, to come to my rescue. Where else can I go? There's no other name by which I am saved. Capture me. Oh, I need you. You, Jesus. This church needs you. This church needs you. This church needs you. We need you. Oh, there's no other name by which I am saved. Won't you capture? Won't you capture? Oh, won't you capture me?
Capture me with grace.
I will follow you. Father, in the name of Jesus, every bondage be released. Every captivity, oh Father, be broken down. I command, oh Father, by the authority and the power that is vested upon the church, I command in the name of Jesus. Satan, you have no hold in the lives of people. You have no hold over any family. You have no hold over any soul. They belong to Jesus. We belong to Jesus. This church belongs to Jesus. And so we declare, O Father, completely solid, secure in you. In Jesus' most precious name, we pray. And all God's saints said, amen, amen. You may go back to your seats and you may be seated in God's presence. Amen. May you experience the deliverance of Jesus. May you experience the deliverance of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Church, can we give the Lord a big, loudest clap offering? Yes. What a message He has for us this morning. We don't want to close our service without welcoming our newcomers. If you said this is your first day to our church, would you please rise up to your feet? Anyone here for the first day? Yes, here it is. Yes, can we give a warm welcome? You're welcome. If you're not part of any church yet, we welcome you in this family of families. One more request. Those who have already stood up, yeah, please remain standing. We will give you a form and also request you to take your belongings and come to the front. We would like to pray with you. Spend a little more time with you. So if you can step out and come to the front, we will take you out. Our newcomers team are here for you. So please come to the front. You can take your belongings, your bags, your belongings. Church, come on, we got to welcome them. This is, yeah, thank you. Till the last person come to the front, we're going to continue clapping for them. Yes. Thank you so much for coming. We have a newcomers team there. Our leaders are waiting for you, so you can follow them. Yeah, we will just take a time to pray with you. So you can follow our newcomers team at the room behind. Thank you. Let us all rise up to our feet and pronounce the benediction. What great love it is, Father. Thank you for your message today. This great love that no mind or heart could fathom or understand is truly for us. Thank you, Abba. Give us the strength to wait on you during this waiting season. Lord, we give you our hands. Hold us. Lead us, Father. Now may the love of the Father, the grace of His Son, Jesus, and the sweet fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us. And His Son said, amen, amen. Have a blessed week.